Evening, everyone.
Good evening, your worship.
Please be seated.
Well, welcome, everyone. Every year, it's kind of like we throw a switch after Labor Day, and everybody's back to full throttle, schools getting back in, and universities and community college, and we're coincidentally right on top of it with our first city council meeting following the summer. So with that, first item of business, Madam Clerk, please.
Roll call, your worship. I've taken the roll, and all members of council are present.
Thank you. Next item, please.
A motion to adopt this evening's agenda would be in order.
Moved by Councilor Lubkey, seconded by Councilor Chaboyer. Any changes or additions? None. I'll call for the question. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Next item, please.
Confirmation of the minutes of the regular meeting of council held August 12th, 2019.
Councilor Cameron, seconded by Councilor Cullen. Any errors, omissions, or changes? Again, seeing none, I'll call for the question. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Next item, please.
Community comments, feedback, your worship?
Yeah, now, well, we have a public hearing later on in the agenda, but this is a portion of the agenda that council holds open for any member of the audience who would like to come forward to provide any comments or feedback about any item on tonight's agenda, and a total of 15 minutes is allowed for this section of the agenda. So if someone has any issues that they want to deal with, perhaps other than the public hearing specific item, they're welcome to come forward now. Not seeing anybody. We've got a number of people in the gallery tonight, which is great to see, but we'll move on to the next item then, please.
Under the order of public hearings, your worship, the consideration of representation regarding the new development concept for 1640 Sycamore Drive.
Very good. So this was the item I mentioned. We do have a public hearing, so the council will now open up a public hearing to hear representation. Now, are we going to have an overview from our administration first, Mr. City Manager, or just going straight into the hearing?
Your worship, I did see Ryan here earlier.
Coming up.
And he's out in the hallway.
Hey.
Maybe that was him on the door. There he is right there. Ryan?
Ryan, we're just opening the public hearing, but I wasn't sure if it was your plan to have an overview before we invite the public to provide feedback, as you often do. So.
Yeah, no, it's absolutely my plan, your worship.
Yeah, very good. Well, then we'll
open the applicants were going to come. I was having a moment of worry there. You don't want to have a public hearing without the applicants. So.
Okay.
My understanding is that council doesn't have this on your computer screen, so I guess you'll have to watch the TVs like everybody else. So today we're here to have a public hearing talking about 1640 Sycamore. And the reason why we're here is there's a new development concept being brought forward. As council probably recalls, this one originally was rezoned years ago. It used to be Kingsway Mobile Home Park, and then there was a little bit of a discrepancy between some of the ownership groups, and each side decided to go their separate way on the development agreement. The council dealt with the one to the south. I'm sure council calls the issue was emergency access, Kelsey Bay, that whole discussion. And now we're dealing with the northern portion of that property with a new development agreement and a new developer. So council knows the property's in South Brandon, all on Sycamore, just to the south of Sycamore and just to the east of 18th Street, shows a little bit closer in on this portion of the site. The portion of the site we're talking about today is that kind of funny shaped parcel on the north, and the property that was previously approved for the new development agreement and has started construction is to the south there. As you can see, there's the existing condominium row house style development to the east, and then the commercial to the west. This shows the original concept for the overall site when everything was kind of working together. And the total unit count at this stage was 440 units with combination of row housing around the edges and larger multi-story buildings in the central area to the site with the majority of underground parking. This shows the development, what's being proposed by the developer on the northern property here today. There'd be two larger buildings, so around 100 units each. They can speak a little bit more in detail to that. All surface parking, so no underground is part of this proposal. Two amenity areas, both around the building to the south, and then parking. Always looks like a lot of parking, but that's because that's just kind of how the requirements are. A lot of units require a lot of parking. Just really a quick overview. The landscape plan shows the two different amenity areas. I'm sure there's residents here from the row housing development to the east. So the original concept, if you go back here, it's really hard to see, but it shows row housing that was within about 7.6 meters, 30 feet from the property line. And that would, those were three-story row house apartments, which was approved. And then the new plan here is that the separation between the building and that property line is significantly greater because you have those, that row of parking. So in that case, you're dealing with 60 feet of parking width plus another 4.5 meter of buffer plus an additional 6 meter buffer that's owned by the condo corp. So just the landscape buffer alone would be 10 meters pretty over I think around 35 feet in width. So when we're talking about separations, buffer actually provides a greater separation to the new plan, although larger buildings on the site. And it shows here on the landscape plan a little bit more detail. As you can see, it's a large site, so it's hard to see, but along the east property line there would be trees that would be planted as well as fencing that would hopefully provide required screening from lights, that type of thing, although that would be fairly unlikely because there's a pretty significant landscape buffer like we talked about between the two properties. As for urban design, the buildings are fronting on the street, so you don't have a bunch of big parking in front. It's part of the aesthetics, makes it look nice. So buildings on the street, parking's internal to the site. Council may wonder why it seems like there's less green space, and it's probably because there is than usual, because it's larger buildings than typically we've seen in Brandon. For the most part, our multi-residential sites are more like 30 unit, 24 units spaced out on sites, and a lot of the green space you see is separations between different buildings on the site, where in this case that's not the case because we're dealing with really large buildings. But there is amenities that are provided, and the developer can speak further, but they've tried to provide a little bit more amenity than maybe we're used to in terms of providing a dog run, community garden green space, and a spot for a playground. Typically, we don't talk about servicing because I don't know much about servicing and things always go wrong because I'm not the engineer, but there's been some questions raised through the process about servicing. So we're just gonna talk about it really briefly. In terms of water and wastewater, it's pretty simple. They're just tying into the mains along the public reserve, in the public reserve there to the west, so not a lot of discussion about that. And I did have, I thought I had another plan on here. Anyways, we'll talk about, you can't really see it anyway, so it doesn't matter, but drainage was the other piece that was brought up through some of the process that we heard and some of the feedback and how drainage is being managed, because we're really used to seeing ponds on sites because ponds got to hold that much water, so you can discharge at a controlled rate so you don't flood out the neighbors. In this case, there's no ponding proposed on the site through like a separate retention facility. What's being proposed, at least at a conceptual level, is that the parking lot would serve as the ponding facility. So if you can think about a large parking lot, when there's a heavy rainstorm event, so let's say that 1 in 100 year event, that's the city standard for the design, the parking lot would fill with water to a certain extent, like not like overflowing, but like there would be a foot of water at the deepest location at the center of the parking aisles, and then it would be stored underground. There would be an outflow, so like a valve at the connection point to the city system that would control the outflow so it wouldn't overflow the system. So from an engineering perspective, it meets the equivalency, like what the city is looking for from a design. And we don't mandate how that has to happen. So we're not saying it has to be a pond. In fact, there was a Maryland school recently managed a lot of their stormwater through using their parking lot to double as a drainage facility. Just making sure I'm getting all my checklists off here. We talked about density. 440 units was part of the original concept. When you add up the two new concepts, it's 402, so actually it's less units than what was originally approved for the overall site. Talked about green space. We talked about the buffering from the lower density residential to the east. Parking always comes up. They are providing more than 1.5 parking stalls. I think there's 20 extra parking stalls. Saying that, and no one likes to hear this, but there is street parking on Sycamore. The street was designed to have street parking on both sides, and I'm sure there will be parking on the street as the street was designed for. The applicant will be constructing a sidewalk, because you got to move people when you have this many people living in the development, so hopefully they can move across the frontage of the street to a crossing. Building height, we're looking at four-story building, so that's permitted in the city of Brandon, even within large RMD zones, which is a lower density zone within the city. So from a height perspective, they're not pushing the height. It's consistent with what went through originally, and that's kind of deemed the right fit for the neighborhood, and at least it was at the time, and the privacy and that type of thing. Access, secondary access isn't an issue on this one. It was on the other ones. They do have two access points, and they're both from Sycamore coming into the site. So down to kind of the details and why we're here is council needs to take a look at the new concept, see if that's kind of generally consistent with the old concept and the right fit for the area. If it is, we're recommending a development agreement, and there'd be just a few conditions in there. The one is constructing the public sidewalk, as I talked about. There's typical water and sewer agreements that just for to address servicing on private property and some liability discussions around there. There would be an easement for servicing, just because that's how the site's getting serviced, is from the west, and that's our water and the wastewater line. So then if you dig it up, they need a little bit more space just because it's a little bit deeper in that area. Need a contribution to plant some trees along Sycamore. There's a cash in lieu for parks because there's no land dedication. We're not taking land for a public park here. They're providing private green space for their residents. There'd be a school's contribution. It's a per unit calculation. And then there'd be just a letter of credit for the sidewalk that needs to get constructed to make sure it's done correctly. One thing that council will probably ask, I'm going to jump you to it, is regarding development charges and how that works. There are no development charge contributions proposed as part of the development agreement, because there was a previous agreement, and it was a settlement agreement regarding contributions for Sycamore that was signed by the city. It's a really one-off kind of thing. There was some legal process discussions. And at the time, there was an agreement between the city and the owner, which is not the applicant, that the only way to settle the agreement was enter a settlement agreement based on a lump sum of cash paid at that point in time, which was $300,000 in exchange for no future infrastructure contributions. So that's why there's no future infrastructure contributions and development charges as part of the development agreement. In terms of engagement, there was no additional engagement required of the applicant. Well, certainly it was recommended. We always recommend people talking to the neighbors, just because it wasn't increasing density of use. And there was an initial engagement when they went through the process, the original developer. Although we did schedule a public hearing, because we always want to err on the side of people knowing. That's especially the development of this scale, and the concept is changing. Although the unit count is not increasing, the concept's changing, and we want to hear what people have to say. And that's why we went ahead and scheduled the public hearing. One of the things that might be brought up is notice. This isn't a statutory public hearing, which that means it's not required by law. This is something we do because it's good practice, and we want to hear from our residents. But we're not obligated by different acts to do it. We're just doing it because it's the right thing to do. From a notice perspective, just due to some internal miscommunication, the notices were not sent out how they typically are, through the mail. And in some cases, then we delay a public hearing, but we did not want to do that, because in this case, we're dealing with our applicants who are out of town and have already booked flights and all these things to come join us for the hearing. So our staff delivered notices by hand 8 days prior to the hearing. So that's why when we might hear some comments that some notices were received later, they were received later, probably by, I'd say, 2 or 3 days, because we always send notices out about 14 days before on snail mail. But regardless, we did provide notice by 8 days, and I think people did receive notice, because we have received comments prior to the hearing, and people are here today because of this this item. Some of the things that we heard from the comments and just from discussions that we had, we talked about drainage management. It's different than what we've seen on a lot of other sites in the city. The discussion around parking and traffic, those always come up. There was a traffic study done. Intersection improvements were not identified, and this area was already zoned for high-density housing, and it's not increasing. It's, in fact, it's slightly decreasing the density on what came up. Buffer, lighting, those types of things from the neighbors talked about it. As I think I showed council, it's addressed through the additional setback as well as the buffer, existing buffer owned and maintained by the condo corp and the fencing, and then the discussion about parking, where they do meet minimum parking requirements. We often know that's not enough. And there will be spillover parking, I'm sure, but that stretch of Sycamore is being designed to have parking on both sides of the street. I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Nickel. We'll open up the floor for council to ask questions. Councillor DiReggio.
Thank you. First, a couple of quick questions. The buffer zone, will that be just flat grass, a berm, trees? Can you elaborate, or is that something the developer will look into?
Councillor Reggio, the applicant can certainly speak to it further, but just based on the plan, it'll be a fence along the property line with high canopy trees, like large canopy trees being grown behind it to provide that visual buffer for the residents. Yeah.
And my second question is about the drainage. It's a new system. I've never heard of it before. I'm just wondering if they have examples where it's in effect. Have they had issues with valves that don't open? How long is the water going to sit in this parking lot? And all these cars obviously are going to have to go out on the street, which could cause a problem in the neighborhood with all the extra traffic on the street. So how effective is this drainage?
So through your worship to Councilor Reggio, I'm going to defer that question to the applicant. They're the ones who have worked with these systems before. Yeah, they'll speak to it.
Councilor Chaboyer.
Thank you, worship, through to Mr. Nickel. I guess my question too was also on the drainage issue, because I recall a few years back when we had the apartment block on, I thought it was on the eastern part of Sycamore, and the building was large, and these buildings are even larger from what I can see. And when you get severe flooding or rainstorms, the amount of water that comes off the roof of these things, the system couldn't sustain it, and it couldn't drain properly. So my question is, as we work closely with the developer and Patrick Pulick, and to talk about making sure that the grates and all the roads and everything are enlarged enough to be able to drain off this water properly, because I remember that was an issue on that other block that was on Sycamore. So that's one question.
Yeah.
And the other question is around visitor parking, which I know you talked about on the street parking, but is there any requirements within the actual property to have some visitor parking in there as well?
Yeah, through your worship, to Councillor Chaboy. So just quickly on the drainage system, and I don't want to speak to it too much because, once again, I'm not the expert, but it would still connect underground to the city system. So within the parking lot, so each parking lot, there'd be different systems that would act kind of like bathtubs, and there'd be a grate within the private property, and then it would go down. And it'd be part of it would be held within the piping that would be under the site, and it would connect to the city main. So there would be no above ground, and they can speak to, again, connection to the city line that would through. So the land drainage system would connect underground.
Excuse me. Yeah, that was the problem with those grates, because I know when fall came and when they started to cover up with leaves and grass, and then the water couldn't get down to the underground system.
I see.
And it become a nightmare. So the thing was, it had to have proper sizing of grates. Councilor Brown, do you recall that?
Yes, I do.
Yeah,
okay.
And so I'm hoping that you remember that issue on the other block we had.
I remember every drainage issue.
in this case,
what the issue was that we had flow coming down Tracy Street, that there was one catch basin trying to capture all of that flow. And in times of a heavy rainfall event, that water would anything that the catch basin didn't capture would bypass and end up on Portola or on Sycamore.
Yes, and so it was ending up on the driveways and up the people's, in their yards and up on their window wells. And,
right. So what we did in that case was we added a second catch basin on Tracy Street to capture that flow. And that resolved the problem. So what Ryan is suggesting is that any of the drainage off this site would actually never reach the city right-of-way. It would all be captured on-site and connect right into our storm sewer system, so you wouldn't have the opportunity to be creating the same issues that we had on Sycamore.
Okay, so when water is going on pavement, you're having drainage in the middle or somewhere so it can go down instead of being spread out to the other streets, correct?
Essentially, that's correct.
Okay. Okay, that's...
So the second question about guest parking, the zoning bylaw requires 15% to be signed for guest parking. So when you're thinking about 200 units and 300 and something, 329 stalls, there'd be 15% of those would be signed. So 39, whatever it is, 30 to 40 stalls would be signed for guest parking.
And Councillor Fawcett?
Yes, thank you, through your worship. This is sort of a small piece in the scale of all this, but I see you've got they're going to do a sidewalk on Sycamore, right?
Yep,
sidewalk on Sycamore?
Yep.
So there is a sidewalk, obviously, all the way down Sycamore on the north side. And unfortunately, on Sycamore, this is the last developable piece. And we're going to have them do a sidewalk. It's the last available piece. Why wouldn't we have had the sidewalk there all along? You know, so will we just put the sidewalk in later, the rest of the way, or is it just going to be that piece of property that has a sidewalk?
Yeah, through your worship to Councillor Fawcett, it's a, like, Sycamore functions like a collector street.
Yes.
So when we're talking about collector streets, the goal is to have sidewalks on both sides, like local street sidewalk one side, collector streets two. So for whatever reason, you know, it didn't happen as part of the overall vision. We're talking about building 200 plus units on this site front, and we got to give people a place to walk. At the very least, this will provide connections to the street crossings that will connect to the other side of the street, which will hopefully connect to the neighborhood. The alternative is having people having nowhere to get to a street crossing, with the hope that the city may over time be able to extend the sidewalk further down, you know, however council sees it going. But at the very least, when we saw it, we thought it would go for the block in front of it that would connect to the crossing.
Your worship, yes. Well, and I see that, and that makes sense. And you would think that inevitably the city will have to now just do the whole street at some point. It's just a strange little chunk otherwise. But I see what you mean. It just seemed stuck out for me.
And Councillor Brown.
Yes, I was just wondering if there's going to be a lot more cars. I was wondering, is there anybody looked at the traffic on Sycamore, the Lindale Drive? You know, we're going to have in the neighborhood of probably 300 for each development, so 600 cars, plus the traffic coming off Tracy Street. And a lot of the neighbors are concerned about the amount of traffic and the speed of the traffic.
Well, three worships to Councillor Brown, so there's kind of two questions in there. The one discussion about the traffic on the impact of the intersection is fair. That's why they did the traffic study, to take a look at the intersection capacity. And once again, the engineers who looked at it kind of confirmed that everything checks out, that this isn't overloading the system and the level of service that the residents can expect, which is always a pretty high level of service in the city of Brandon because we don't like to wait. The other discussion around speed and that side of things certainly will increase. But the discussion around speed, as you get more street parking, which you inevitably will, people actually drive slower. They always do. Like, that's the nature of people drive to whatever the conditions are. And a busier street, like in terms of people parking on the street, generally is a safer street. So they're not always directly interrelated.
Hey, Councilor Lupke.
Thank you, Your Worship. Through you to Mr. Nickel. You mentioned about the street crossing from the south sidewalk that'll be built to the north sidewalk. Is there any plans at this point to have a pedestrian specific crosswalk there, one that's either got signs or lights or anything of that nature, Ryan?
Through your worship to Councillor Lupke, we did not talk about a pedestrian specific crossing, but I'll flag that as something to take back to our engineering team.
Thank you.
And Councillor Parker.
Thank you, Your Worship. Through you to Mr. Nickel. I was just looking for the graphics. We don't, like you said, we don't have the same presentation that you had, but I was looking for the how the buildings were going to face and I think I just found it here somewhere else. So one faces north to Sycamore, is that correct?
Sir, I have my presentation back up here if you can float, stick it back up. Yeah.
Okay.
So Sycamore is to the north, so that first building there is directly facing Sycamore.
So the only buffer then, my question was the buffer zone between there and the row homes, but it's facing
correct
the end of the building as opposed to the face of the building.
Correct. The row homes are to the east.
Right.
So when you look at this landscape plan, you see on the east there's that buffer area. It's about 4.5 meters.
Yeah.
And there's a row of trees and a fence. That's what's between the row house development and this development.
Perfect. Thanks.
Okay, I didn't have any other hands up for Mr. Nicol right now. Councilor Reggio?
Your Worship, I'm just wondering if we can get Mr. Kulak back as part of the city presentation. I just wanted to know if he feels comfortable with the drainage system that they have, if he's familiar with it.
I might suggest, because I think we're going to be having the applicant that may be talking more specifically about that, and then maybe that would be the time to have Mr. Kulak after we hear the applicant and your opportunity to question the applicant on the drainage system.
Okay, thank
that
you.
Makes sense. Councillor Fawcett?
Yes, thank you, through your worship. One more question for Ryan here. I just maybe not reading this right. But the exit, so there's two entrance and exits, both of them on Sycamore?
Yeah, through your worship to Councillor Fawcett, that's correct.
Sorry, because then there is that Willowdale.
Willowcrest,
but it is not accessible because it's owned by a different developer, is that?
Yeah, through your worship to Councillor Fawcett, like it looks like a really logical way to get out of the property,
sure does,
and it's something we identified, and the applicant can speak to why that's not possible as a way, but it is a private access, so the city can't force the arrangement to come off the site that way.
Yeah, so I just wanted to make sure I was clear on that, because it will, when we do put it up there, it's going to look quite odd that people would think, well, there's another exit, but it's a private property thing.
Yeah, through your worship, Councillor Fawcett, you have this kind of long row of parking. It seems like that's a logical way to get out. It just, for whatever reason, hasn't worked out with these developments proceeding.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other questions? Mr. Nicol, of course, we can bring him back later if questions arise. We do with our staff, so very good. Thank you, Ryan. So it's customary prior to opening up the hearing to the public to hear from the applicant so they can more fully explain their presentation and answer questions of council. So welcome.
We had a presentation as well.
Yes.
PowerPoint. Good evening, Mayor, Council, staff. Thank you for having us. My name is Rachel Ricard. I am the Assistant Development Manager with Broad Street Properties. I'm here tonight with Chris Melman, who is the COO and Executive Vice President. We have a small presentation for you, after which we can answer any questions you may have.
All right, so just a quick little brief explanation on who we are. So Sycamore Pacific Development, Broad Street Properties. We are a rental builder. We're based out of Campbell River on Vancouver Island in BC. We build apartment rentals across Western Canada. We develop, build, own, and manage them all in-house, so very incorporated. We're family-owned and operated. We manage about 8,500 units across Western Canada right now. We do about 10 projects a year, so pretty much a lot of experience in very similar projects kind of across Western Canada, including Winnipeg. Kind of the Broad Street realm, we kind of focus on seven key factors in our rental management. So obviously that's community, functionality of the properties, appearance, safety for our clients, aka also tenants, quality, flexibility for tenants for different lease options, and then what we like to call is the love it factor. We like to treat these rentals as people's homes, so making sure they're comfortable. Like I said, we have lots of experience in this, so kind of in Manitoba in general, we've done about, I think, 15 of these projects similar, being in Winnipeg, Winnipeg, Portage Prairie, and Selkirk. So, sites Winnipeg. So kind of overall vision we had for this property. So obviously envision another multifamily residential community, site with ample residential park, or ample amenity space, sorry, community gardens, dog runs, playground for children, you know, that's able to provide kind of luxurious lifestyle at affordable pricing. So, over to Rachel.
Perfect.
For a little bit on the site itself.
So Ryan did a really great job of outlining our project, so I'll be brief here. Our proposed project, Aspen Greens, is located at 1640 Sycamore Drive. Prior to requesting a new development agreement, we engaged a traffic engineer to complete a traffic impact analysis and a civil engineering firm to complete a servicing analysis. The conclusion of the traffic analysis was that there would be no significant issues at the intersections of Sycamore and Tracy, Sycamore and Lindale, and 18th Street and Lindale. The traffic analysis did note a pre-existing pedestrian deficiency in the pedestrian facilities, which has been addressed by the city requesting the construction of a sidewalk in front of the site, which we happily agreed to. The servicing analysis found that the surrounding existing infrastructure was capable of accommodating this proposed development. So I'll touch a bit on the amenities. We have in Building A, that fronts Sycamore Street, we will have an indoor amenity space. In there, we'll have a living room type seating, a large TV, kitchen facilities that tenants can use. We also have outdoor amenity space. We have a playground, community gardens, an off-leash dog run. Off-leash dog run, and then ample green space for active recreation. We also have a covered seating area next to the dog run for passive enjoyment, and this encourages social engagement of tenant neighbors. We also have a couple of benches on the playground, too, for parents to watch the children. Each of the buildings features a contemporary design with... A contemporary design with shed projections to break up the roof line. The facade of the buildings is articulated with bump outs and balconies for each unit. Siding materials will be a blend of cement board, shaken board in natural earth tones. Building A that you see here in this rendering, which fronts Sycamore Street, will also feature ground floor walkout units. So this allows tenants to access the street directly from the unit without having to go down the hall through the lobby and out the front door. So walkout units promote walkability to schools and parks, and the sidewalk provides increased level of safety for pedestrians. The site plan, as Ryan mentioned, has been designed to capture all of the parking internally and uses the building along Sycamore Street to screen the parking from view. Additionally, we have 6-foot fencing that will be along all of the property lines except for Sycamore Drive, and landscaping, which will provide additional screening for parking and glare from headlights. The parking lot will be lit with light standards that project light downward and minimize light pollution on adjacent properties. And Ryan touched on some of the zoning requirements. So the site is zoned residential high density. The maximum density on the site is 148 units per hectare. Aspen Green proposes 95 units per hectare, which is below what is allowable. Both our buildings are under the allowable maximum height, and we have provided 17 additional parking stalls over what is required. Ryan had a bit of a higher number. That's because we took out some of the parking stalls to add parking lot planting islands within the parking lot to help break up the expanses of parking there. So in conclusion, Aspen Greens is a thoughtfully planned rental community that will fit in with the scale and character of the surrounding neighborhood. And we're really looking forward to adding this project to our portfolio and to becoming members of the community of Brandon.
Thank you very much. Needless to say, I'm sure there'll be questions from some members of council, so we'll open the floor for that now, starting with Councillor Reggio.
Thank you very much. I'm sure you heard my question, and that has to do with
with the drainage, using the parking lot as a pond. Have you had any issues in the past? Because I know in my ward, we've had flooding issues with heavy rains. So I'm just wondering, is there a contingency, a backup in case the valves don't work, or how's that going to work?
Through your worship. So, yeah, through this design, it's designed to use lots across multiple projects in Alberta, Saskatchewan, and Manitoba. It is pretty typical for surface parking development. And yes, so pretty much how Patrick explained it, or sorry, Ryan explained it, sorry. Yeah, so it's designed to store water on site. It's much shallower than he explained. It's around, you know, 3 to 4 inches deep on the 1-in-100-year storm, not the 1 foot that he mentioned. And then the valve doesn't actually open and close, it's just at a release rate. So it's just the size of the orifice that goes into the city. Pressure will only allow so much water through. Not an actual operating valve that opens and closes.
So there'll be a constant drain as long as it doesn't get plugged?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, other questions? Councilor Cameron.
Thank you, Your Worship. I was just wondering if you could, just because it came across fairly fast, so for people that are in the room or at home, if you could speak to kind of the unit breakdown, what you're looking at for, you know, obviously we've heard number of units, but what...
Can we go back to that presentation? What is available? I think we have the breakdown on the one slide there. We did breakdown, yeah. So up on the top box there, so one bedroom, 49 one bedroom units, two bedroom, two bath, 122, two bedroom, one bath, 13, and then three bedroom, two bath, that is 24.
If I could just do a quick follow-up, these units are all at market rate. There's not an affordable component in there at all. It's all market rate housing, or market rate rentals, sorry.
That's correct, yeah.
Any other questions that council may have? Councilor Brown?
That concerns from the citizens about the trees. It's a beautiful piece of property. People like your concept. They're wondering, are you going to be able to save a lot of them trees? It's like a park almost in there.
Yeah, through your worship. So obviously with how the site layout is, along the two property lines,
the
east and west, there's potentially saving some trees along there until we can get a full survey and see where they line up with our parking lot. We can't guarantee it. We haven't gotten that far to our design yet.
There are quite a few people too who would like to see those cotton trees taken out of there.
If you want them gone, we'll cut them down. If you want to save them, we'll try our best.
Yeah, that did seem to be a double-edged sword, because yeah, we did have written presentations. The cottonwood trees are causing problems for people in the neighborhood in terms of plugging up drains and air conditioners, and yet they would like green space. So
being from BC, I do enjoy big trees, so we can keep them. We like to try, but obviously just throughout development, setting grades, obviously you can't bury trees and stuff like that, so it can be difficult sometimes. So.
Thank you.
And Councilor Fawcett?
Yes, thank you, through your worship, to the presenters. Have you had any discussion with the other property owner about that Willowcrest and the easements and things like that? It just, as an option, it is one of those things that over time we'll look at maps and that and think, why is nobody going out there? But it would have to be an easement because it is private property.
Through your worship, we haven't had those direct conversations with the developer of the woods. When we first looked at this, we thought that was a public road, so we looked at potentially an access through there, realized it was not, so we kind of looked at site design to have the two off of Sycamore there. So.
Okay, you're finished, Councilor Foss.
Yeah, I can't force people to talk to each other. If they would like to, they can.
Yeah. And Councilor Shway?
Thank you, Worship. Through to the developer and maybe perhaps engineering. I have another question about capacity. This is a fairly large development, and there's been a lot of development in the region overall. Have you been reassured by engineering, and can engineering confirm for us that there is a lot of room for capacity for sewer? Because that's a lot of showers, that's a lot of toilets, That's a lot of water flowing into our system. Are we okay with that, or are we getting to a point where our sewer system can only handle so much?
So you're talking domestic sewer as opposed
yes.
to drainage? Yeah. I don't know if you can speak to that.
Yeah, so through your worship there, so obviously through this process, we had to do a servicing brief, which analyzes the existing sewer capacity or the existing use of the sewer, takes in what our contribution will be. They analyze that, and through that, our servicing brief is outlined that the existing infrastructure can handle what we're proposing.
Okay. Other questions of the developer? We can have the engineer come back up after if there's something more specific you want to verify. But okay, that appears to have covered. So thank you very much. Very thorough presentation. Or before I open up the hearing to members of the public, which I would like to soon do, but were there any other questions of administration? Again, we can ask them to come back perhaps after we've heard some of the concerns and comments from residents. So with council's permission, we will now open the hearing then. So anyone wishing to come forward to speak either in favor or against this development or just general comments, we would welcome them right now. Come ahead.
Your worship.
Welcome, sir.
My name's Dennis Bercy. I live at 6 Birchwood Drive. My backyard is directly onto the property that's being proposed for development. So as a private citizen, I have some concerns, and it's general comments that I want to make as opposed to endorsing or opposing this particular project. With regard to the landing, I serve a dual role. I'm also the president of the Brandon Condominium Corporation number 95. So some of my comments will be as a result of some of the questions they have as well. And they represent the 221 units in the landing. Firstly, council has certainly addressed some of our concerns, at least asked the questions. As far as the condominium corporation, we certainly are concerned about the drainage issue. Previous developments have had retention ponds and have also had a different type of water management system. To this point, I hadn't heard any type of management system had been planned for this particular development. Mr. Nickel did a good job of explaining it, and you know, we trust that will accomplish what it sets out to do. As far as the development itself, some of the concerns raised by members of the landing deal with the capacity of the roads and the safety of the people in the area. This, of course, is going to add a considerable amount of volume to traffic. And from my discussions with the planning department, it is their intention to monitor this situation over a period of time to see how it pans out. My understanding was the last traffic study was done in 2018. Since that time, the Groves development has come online, as well as this development is also going to become online in the near future. You can project so much, but until it actually arrives, you don't know exactly what it's going to give you. So we would encourage that it be monitored on a frequent basis, not just once every 2 years or whatever the standard is. There were some comments with regard to the present property that is being developed. My understanding from my discussions with the planning branch is the buffer zone on the east side of the proposed development actually belongs to the condominium corporation. There's a 20-foot buffer zone that actually belongs to the corporation. Is this the same buffer zone that we're talking about? I'm not sure. Perhaps that question could be answered for me. With regard to the development itself, on the east side of the development, we ask that adequate buffer zone be put in to sort of deal with the lighting and the traffic that is going to be going through the parking lot. And from my understanding, we're looking at trees of a larger nature, plus a 6-foot fence, if I understand correctly. You know, that would help mitigate that as well. Should council approve this application and it reach the construction phase, one of our concerns is the amount of construction traffic that we have coming into the area itself. We've been inundated with construction vehicles for a number of years now, and it has a tendency to leave the roads at some points in a muddied, a very messy situation. So we would be asking that, if at all possible, that if it does reach the construction phase, that access to the property be done from Lindale Drive. That could be through a negotiated agreement with the people south of us or whatever. However, to attempt to mitigate the amount of traffic from the construction vehicles coming into the area of the landing and on Sycamore Drive. Sycamore Drive is increasingly under pressure from. Those are basically my comments, Your Worship. The Condominium Association, as I said, we don't endorse the project, but we don't object to the project. So we trust that the concerns of our community will be met, and I'm sure a number of people, as well as myself, will have comments with regard to this.
Very good. Would you answer any questions if council had any, Mr. Bercier?
Sure.
Yeah, and just for your information, council did receive the written submission that you'd made previously, which it was also very thorough and professional, so that was quite helpful to us as well. So open up the floor for any questions of Mr. Bercier. Councillor DeJarlie.
Thank you, Your Worship. Very, very quickly, because I read your letter, and did you want to echo any sentiments from Councillor Brown regarding the lovely cottonwood trees?
Well, I like trees. The poplar trees, the cottonwood trees. Myself and my wife have lived there for 5 years, and from about the beginning of June to about the end of August, we can't use our backyard. I have to clean my air conditioner about 4 times a year. All our filters are getting plugged up, so they're a problem. And if at all possible, I would encourage their removal at least. I'm not saying all trees, but for sure the cottonwood trees.
Yeah, Mr. Percy, you have support from this councillor for that. I have a neighbor with a cottonwood tree, and we have done what we can. We're trying to work toward removal of said tree, and I think I said those exact same words to my neighbor earlier this year. So hopefully there will be a moratorium on cottonwoods in Brandon.
Well, as a matter of fact, Councillor DeJarlie, the last development that had been proposed, I had written in, complained about the same property.
Okay, Councillor Reggio.
Thank you, Your Worship, through you to Mr. Bursey. Just quickly, if my notes are correct, Mr. Nichols said there would be a 35-foot buffer zone. You mentioned 20 feet belong to the condo corp. So there would be an additional 15.
Perhaps it's an additional, is what he said.
So was 35 feet sufficient?
I would say, but I mean to the property line. I mean, from what I've gathered, it's 107 feet to the edge of the building itself. Most of that is parking lot, and then there's a small, I mean, it'd be 35 feet buffer, so is that correct? That would be from the parking lot, 35 feet. Now I'm assuming there's going to be a 6-foot fence in between that as well.
Okay. But is that, will that meet your...
Well, I live there, and I guess time will tell, but I suppose it would be sufficient.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions, Mr. Bercier, before he departs? In fact, that's it. Thank you very much, Dennis.
Thank you,
Bercier. Okay. We continue to open the hearing. Others are more than welcome to come forward. Please come ahead.
Good evening. My name is Linda Meyer, and I also live on Birchwood. I have the corner property on Birchwood and Sycamore. So this proposed development obviously affects my property and my privacy and my peace, basically. My main concern is the on-street parking, the walkout units, which will probably or most likely promote more on-street parking because of the convenience to walk out of the door and enter into your car rather than going to the parking lot. I'm also very concerned about the sidewalk that would be adjacent to my property line. So right now I have a dining room window looking out onto Sycamore. So basically I'm going to be having on street parking along with pedestrians walking right along my fence line. When I bought the property, I was assured that the sidewalk would be on the north side of Sycamore. So I wasn't anticipating traffic, foot traffic, or parking on my side of the street. It doesn't allow much of a buffer zone from the curbside to the actual fence of my property. So those are my major concerns. I also would like to address to council and to the city that I feel that 5 days notice to the community was not sufficient, and that to allow residents to examine this. Basically, I came home from work. It was delivered in my mailbox for Monday night. We fell into a long weekend. We also fell into parents getting their children prepared to go back to school. I don't feel that 5 days have been a sufficient time for the residents to actually examine this and ask questions about this proposal. I'm concerned again about the on-street parking as well, because there's, 210 units? Most households have two cars per unit. There probably isn't sufficient enough parking to hold this. So again, we're going to have street parking probably right from the apartments right up Sycamore. If you examine Tracy, which has the Groves plus another rental unit, the parking from 4 o'clock on is from Patricia on street parking, is car to car, bumper to bumper, from Patricia Avenue right to the new development of the Groves, basically. That, so I can't see any difference in it being any different on Sycamore. It will be bumper to bumper cars parked, basically, especially with the walkout units, which will promote people just walking out their unit and climbing into their car rather than going around to the parking lot. So those are my concerns. I would hope that council would allow another 2 weeks for the residents to examine this proposal. I think there's a very small showing here. That I'm also concerned about light pollution. Now I know that the lights will shine down onto the parking lot, but how tall are the lights going to be, basically? Are they going to infringe on our backyards and light up the sky, because this is an extensive parking lot? And I think that basically we were given a notice showing the outside buildings, but very, very little information was given to this notice. And myself, I dove into it with the city to see, to ask questions and so forth, but I'm sure a lot of the residents are unaware of it. Thank you.
Would you entertain any questions? I'm not sure if there are some, but we usually like to give counsel in case they needed to clarify anything, so I'll just open that up. Counselor Reggio?
Thank you, Your Worship. I just want just a quick question. When you purchased your home, who assured you that there wouldn't be a sidewalk on the north end?
The developers.
Okay, thank you.
On the north end, on the south end.
South end, okay, thanks.
Mm-hmm. And Counselor DeJarlin?
Thank you, through Your Worship, to the resident. Thank you for coming. I believe Ryan, when he felt that he wished he could have got the notice out sooner, but that it wasn't statutory, so it wasn't an obligation. It was more of a gesture of goodwill, and unfortunately, it left a sour taste in your mouth. This gesture of goodwill, right, to reach out to the public. I'm wondering some of the concerns you had. Might not be deal breakers. Have you had an opportunity to approach the developer in regards to the lighting and for your concern around it infringing in your backyard?
No, I haven't had a chance to approach the developer, but I have had a chance to approach the city.
Okay. And I don't know what the developer, I think most use LED lighting now, yeah, as opposed to HPS, so that doesn't diffuse in the same way, and so there shouldn't be any light pollution heading up to the sky, just for your reference. No.
Yes.
Councilor Brown?
I'm your councilor for the area, mm-hmm, and I live almost across the street from you, and I was just wondering if there's any way this sidewalk could be moved away from your premises, because I know you have a couple dogs, they bark a lot. And there's people along by her fence and her yard. It's you're going to hear them all over the place, though. You know, they're your pets. Can't ask you to get rid of them.
No, and I'm not prepared to get rid of them.
I don't know if there's something that the city and developer can do about cutting down the sidewalk somewhat.
So there's no sidewalk.
Or putting a privacy fence along my. Along my property line.
So it's not fenced now,
it's
on your north side?
It's 4-foot chain link fence.
Oh, I see. Okay.
And I think that's a reasonable consideration from the developers to add that. Any other questions?
Okay, sorry, I was taking notes there. Did any other counselor have a question? Okay, very good. Thank you very much, Ms. Meyer. And we'll keep this hearing open as long as we have to hear everybody that wants to speak. So please come in.
Good evening, Mayor and Council people. My name is Jeanette Wilson. I live in the Landing. I am a retired teacher, and I worry about those little people who are going to be going to school starting tomorrow. When I first moved into the Landing back in 2013, I watched as a confused group of little kids were standing at the entrance to the Landing off of Sycamore, and they weren't really sure where they were to get on the bus or what they were doing, and so they were running around and playing. And there's no special sign or spot that's available for traffic to know that these little guys are going to be there. Now, over time, we've increased the amount of people that live in the area. And when I first moved into the Landing, I could stop at the Landing entrance and Sycamore Street. And it was like, why in the world do we have a stop sign? Because there was very little traffic. I never had to wait. Now, I have to wait, so I know the traffic has increased. Okay, so at 8:30 in the morning, leaving the Landing to get onto Sycamore, yeah, well, bring coffee and a muffin because you're going to be there. Well. And now this development wants to put two more entrances onto Sycamore. Well, bring two coffee and two muffins because I'm going to be sitting at the entrance I use on Orchard Way. It could be a while. Okay? So that's one of my worries, and with that increase in traffic, and you say there's been a study done, I get that, okay? Is there some way between the city and the school division that there can be a spot, you know, designated for where these kids are going to be? Like I say, the small ones that day, I know they were new to the landing, and it was just kind of scary because you got little kids running around. And with increased parking on the streets, you know, we don't always see these little people. Okay? That's just my comment. My concern was for them. Okay? Any questions?
Well, I'll lead off. Just to clarify, so you're looking for sort of like a designated school bus stop? Is that?
Yeah, the, is it possible?
So like, there's not something now? Like,
there's no spot marked, nothing. I mean, it.
But where it, do they stop? Where do they just.
Well, and it's changed. Sometimes they've gone down Aspen, okay, they've come on off Sycamore and on to Aspen and come down the street and picked up kids. Other times they've picked up at the east end entrance of the landing, and other times they have picked kids up at the Orchard Way turnoff off of Sycamore. So, you know, I mean, if I don't know what's happening, you know, so I don't know if there's been changes. Like I say, it would be nice if there was a spot designated, and then if you're going to have all, you know, new residents, you know, there should be another spot for, you know, like to pick these kids up. Sure. Especially with a new school being put up that's for nursery to grade 8 students, you're going to have.
Yeah. Well, I can tell you this much. We do have our council has an excellent working relationship with the school board, and we actually meet twice a year to exchange issues of mutual interest and whatnot, and this would certainly be type of topic that we would, you know, bring forward to the school board. I'm sure they would be, you know, very interested hearing that, and so it's kind of an easy one for us to deal with. Thanks for your input there, and we could see if something a little more coordinated could come about. But now I saw a bunch of hands coming up.
That's
the same suggestion. Maybe Councillor Brown is a ward councillor. You had your hand up in response to this, did you?
I was just going to mention that it's not just one or two school buses. We have probably 7 to 10 of them come there morning and evening, and just thinking of Mrs. Myers' house, that could we not give her a little bit of a no parking zone beside her house because she's close to a corner?
Yeah, sure. Some of those fine details can be worked out as things come along. Should this be approved? So, good. Okay. Any other questions of Ms. Wilson? Yeah, we'd be glad to bring the topic up. This sounds like it's a existing concern with or without this development, right? So, okay, thank you. Okay. Continue and keep the hearing open. So please come ahead if you've got more questions. Please come in.
I'm fairly new at this. My name is Marilyn Rowe. I live 23 White Ash, so I'm in the landing as well. And I want to reiterate what Jeanette said, basically about the numbers of kids is increasing, and sometimes it's really scary in the morning seeing some of those groups of kids congregating and really having no stop. So I reiterate that as well. That is a concern for me. It's a concern ongoing. Now with more people coming in, someone, I can't remember which counselor, had mentioned something about a possibility of having a crosswalk from the new development to wherever. But I think there is going to need to be a crosswalk there, particularly for kids and for people with carriages and so on. So that's one thing. The other thing is I have a huge interest in walking paths and access. Basically, I bike, I walk. There's a lot of people who walk their dogs, and you know, their pets are out there all the time. And if there was any possibility of having some sort of connection between some of the developments. This one is coming in, so I'm putting in a word for the people that are coming in. Is there a way to have access to walking paths as well? That's
good feedback.
Pretty much.
Okay.
That's it for me.
Thank you. Any questions the council may have? Mr. Presenter, Councilor Reggio.
Thank you. You know, no one has asked this question, so I'll be quite blunt and ask, are you in favor of this development? I mean, is it a deal breaker?
I'm not directly affected, but I'm concerned particularly about kids. And there's going to be a lot more traffic coming onto the street. There's a huge group of kids that congregate at Orchard and Sycamore. I'm worried about them, that's for sure. And there's going to be a huge number of kids coming from the new development. I'd like to know how they're going to get picked up and where they're going to get picked up. We have a new school going in, so clearly they're going to be going to it to a certain extent. So we need to do some thinking ahead about protecting them and making sure that they're safe. And then for all us old folks, and for young folks too, who like to bike and walk, I'd like to see access, walking and biking paths.
Well, to the last.
Am I in favor or opposed? 50-50. How's that?
Thank you.
Anybody else have any questions?
Yeah, any other questions? I can assure both yourself and Ms. Wilson, I think our next meeting with the school board is likely in October, so it's not far away. So kind of notwithstanding this development at all, we'll be able to raise this issue and get people working on this better coordination of pickup and drop-off of school bus kids. So we'll actually get Councilor Brown to help us a little bit with the frequency and the number of buses that come in the area there. So, Councilor DeGarlo?
Thank you, through your worship. And maybe just those who have spoken about the students, the children, do you think that now the city and the municipality has some control over the speed limit on our roads? It used to be provincial jurisdiction and it's now a municipal jurisdiction. Do you think there's any merit in us looking at a reduced speed along there, given the amount of
can I speak to that for a moment?
Yeah, sure.
I don't think anybody follows the speed limit.
Right. So if we were to like look at signage and reducing speed, do you think that that's something that we would?
It would probably be a good idea, but honestly.
You know, I lament that
I
we
don't
make,
think anybody.
You know, aside from Councillor Brown, who lives in the area, I lament that we sit here and we kind of make decisions about these kinds of things without having a vision or an image as to the concern. You know, I understand your concerns. But it'd be great if we were down there and we had this outdoor meeting right now and we were able to have a look at the area and, you know, be able to make decisions that way.
This is just my own personal opinion. It's very difficult to drive 20 kilometers per hour. I mean, you're basically idling your way along. And I'm not, you know, that's kind of slow sometimes, but people are driving far faster than the speed limit, period, like the regular speed limit. I know they are. Okay.
Thanks.
Okay, Councilor Brown.
One thing we've noticed and we talk about in the neighborhood when they have the traffic counts, which we've had them do a few times, drivers drive really nice. They see them out there sitting on their chairs, signs flashing the speed limit. Once they're gone.
Oh, well, we can work on that. We might have to get the former policeman back up here for some technical advice here, but we'll continue to keep the hearing open. We want to make sure we hear all points of view, so please come ahead.
I'm Brenda McLeod, and I'm on Birchwood Drive. My primary interest is with the traffic and the vehicles. And between Lindale Drive and Magnolia, you could have as many as 2,000 cars at any given time with the occupancy in the landing and the groves, as well as the new development. It's a highway. I don't know how you can address it, but the two accesses are just going to cause a huge problem. Can Lindale take all that traffic? Like,
well, apparently we'll get our
going the same direction at the same time. It's
so it was required that a proper engineering traffic study be done that, you know, they calculate these out, and apparently it can handle it. We can certainly ask for a greater verification of that, because it's certainly come up a number of times here, and we would want to ensure that the facilities can handle it.
My other question was, is parking going to be included in the cost of the rental for these units? Or are they going to be paying extra for a parking spot? If they are paying extra, they will not be parking in the parking lot. They'll be parking everywhere. That's my issue.
Very good. Any questions the council may have of Ms. McLeod? Got it covered. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Hearing is still open, so please come ahead if you've got a new question or new point of view. Welcome.
Your Worship, councillors. My name is Steve McMillan from VBJ Developments. Just a couple questions, not for or against the proposal, but related to the sidewalk that's going in. Has there been anything discussed about, like, how far it's going? So, I mean, it doesn't make sense for them to have to do it just in front of their property. Like, is it going to Lindale? Is it going just to Tracy Street? Is it extending to Magnolia? Kind of what's happening there? So that's one question. The other one was related to the access. I'm just wondering on the west access point why it's not lining up to Orchard Way. We've had a few projects where we've had offset access points and we were forced to line them up. And I've been told it's because it's, I think, at 25 meters or 20 meters separation, so it just falls outside of it. But we've been in the same circumstance and we were forced to line them up. So I'm just wondering if that was discussed at all.
Orchard Way directly to the north across Sycamore?
Yeah, like if you look at the access points, I mean, the one on the east side is fine, but the one on the west side, it doesn't line up with the access into the landing. It's offset by, there's no measurement, so I'm just assuming it was roughly 20 meters maybe. So just if that was looked at. And then the other issue was just the drainage. So we just finished the Groves development and we ended up having to put a pond in there and lose four buildings because the land drainage sewer pipe was at capacity under major storm events. So we had to actually increase the size of our pond and we're forced to put it in. So I'm just wondering, I'm sure the what's being allowed now can work. But I mean, why didn't we get that same, you know, option to do that? It also says it's going to have a foot of water in the parking lot, which will then idle down, which is fine. But we were told that our pond had to be enlarged so that at some point, like, it's just going to be closed off until that pipe empties out. So, like, we're going to retain all the water on our site for a certain amount of time before we're even allowed to start draining in. So I'm just wondering if that was addressed. If it has, fine, but there just could be an issue with that. But yeah, so really just a couple questions, not against the development. I think it, you know, it'll be good, but just a couple things want to make sure we're looked at as all.
Okay. Any questions of Mr. McMillan while he's up? We'll certainly take these under advisement, your observations or questions as well. Any questions of Mr. McMillan by council? Seeing none, thank you, Steve. And we continue to keep the hearing open until we've heard all points of view that want to be heard. I don't want to get too hasty, so it's looking like we're running out of speakers, so I'll ask just one last time if anyone would like to come forward and speak for or against or just in general about the development. Appears not, so I motion to conclude the hearing would be in order, please. Moved by Councilor Parker, seconded by Councilor Brown. Call for the question on that. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. So this item will be dealt with under another division of the agenda, which is actually quite shortly, so we'll be right back to it. So next item, Madam Clerk.
Committee reports, Your Worship, and I'm not aware of any, but...
Any verbal committee reports that we were not aware of? Not seeing any, so next item, please.
The order of inquiries, Your Worship.
You know, we've got a couple of inquiries tonight. Councilor Reggio.
Thank you, Your Worship. I'll make it short and sweet, but over the weekend, I received a couple of inquiries from residents in the Waverly School area. They've been notified that repaving of the portion of the park is going to be starting today, and that prompted the question, with two summer months of no kids in school, why are we repaving the street when school starts and there's an increase in traffic and kids, school buses, when we could have had it done in July and August?
Mr. Sage has a response for us.
Your Worship, through you to Councilor Reggio. This response is provided by Mr. Aaron Kaluzniak, Manager of Infrastructure and Engineering. It is always the goal of engineering to complete work in the vicinity of school zones during July and August when school is out. In this particular case, processing of asphalt materials by the contractor was delayed, and the schedule unfortunately got pushed into September. The plan is to coordinate with the Brandon School Division and complete the work during professional development days when school is not in session.
I thank you for the response, and hopefully that'll alleviate some of the concerns in the neighborhood.
Thank you. And next one, Councilor Lupke.
Thank you, Your Worship. As there's reference to City Council's strategic plan and the Investing in Canada Infrastructure Program item on tonight's agenda, I was wondering if Council could be provided an update on the development of the formal strategic plan document that was to be based on our strategic planning session that was held at the end of April.
And again, Mr. Sage has a response provided by the City Clerk.
Yes, Your Worship, through you to Councilor Lupke. This is provided by Ms. Heather Awazic, our Director of Legislative Services. City Council met on April of 2019 to develop the strategic plan for the duration of this current term of office. Six strategic directions were agreed upon. Number one, create a community-wide economic strategy. Number two, develop a long-term recreational capital and operations program. Number three, create a long-term infrastructure replacement and maintenance program based on an asset management strategy. Number four, continue with downtown improvements with a downtown enhancement program. Number five, improve community-wide responsiveness to social challenges. And number six, generate a financially sustainable model. The strategic planning report has been provided by the facilitator and delivered to the city. A meeting has been scheduled later in September for Council to review this report and discuss the specific action plans required to implement these directions. The prioritized listing of projects that will be submitted under the Investing in Canada Infrastructure Program align with the six strategic directions identified by City Council, as well as the community need.
Thank you. Thank you. And Councilor Parker?
Thank you, Your Worship. I didn't get this in early as there was a glitch in the system that forgot to remind me to do that. But with swimming season over, I'm wondering if now I can ask administration to put together a somewhat comprehensive overview of the Kinsman pool, condition report, estimated cost to make it something, usage, that type of stuff, water cost increases over the last, if we could do a 2 or 3 year comparison so we can get to bring weather factors and such into the mix. And I know it's not something we can do today or tomorrow or next week, but if we can get it in a reasonable time frame, if we could put that together for the folks, that'd be great.
Very good. We'll take that under advisement, and I'm sure we can pull that information together. Councilor Cameron?
Thank you, Your Worship. I had a late-breaking one, as well as Councilor Parker had mentioned there. I was just wondering if the City Manager could take under advisement or look at in the future. I know one of the proposals coming forward with the 2020 budget is looking at the rectangular rapid flashing beacons for the corner of Victoria and McDermott Drive. Through Councillor Barry, We did have another resident reach out and ask if that was something that could be considered in the stretch as well, between the corner of 18th and Lorne and the corner of 18th and Louise, where the students are crossing in front of Brandon University. I don't expect an answer this evening, obviously, but just hoping that the city manager would take it under advisement and provide a response in future to council.
Right.
Your worship, through you to Councillor Cameron. Councillor Cameron spoke to me earlier about this issue. As council will recall, the update from Sam Van Heusen, our manager of traffic, indicated that the new pedestrian signals on Victoria Avenue and McDermott were going to be a pilot project. And the bonus with that is the city and MI will work together on that pilot project, and we'll see how they work. It's been my experience when testing new devices such as this, similar to the countdown pedestrian crossing signals. When we first tried that, it was a joint effort between the city and MI. They proved very positive, and now you start to see them in a lot of other intersections. I would suggest that if the Victoria Avenue, McDermott Avenue intersection equally is as positive, we could start to see some of these overhead crosswalk signs that I think are a little maybe antiquated, don't work as well as they should these days. We could start to see some changes, but this will be referred to Sam for review, and we can provide a later update at a later date.
Thank you very much.
Any other late breaking inquiries we weren't aware of? Okay, seeing none. Next item of business, Madam Clerk.
The order of announcements, Your Worship.
Announcements this evening. Councillor DeJarle.
Thank you, through Your Worship. If you'll give me a moment, I'm going to read parts of an email from the Indigenous Community Coordinator, Jason Gobay. Jason reached out, and these were his words. Reconciliation is only a word if not followed by action, and here in Brandon we've been fortunate to have a loving and caring community that has answered the call with our actions in supporting and developing working relationships with our Indigenous community of Brandon and the surrounding region. The city of Brandon serves as the urban center for 12 First Nations, the Southwest region of the Mounted Métis Federation, and for the many Indigenous peoples attending one of the numerous secondary and post-secondary education centers in Brandon. Indigenous people are also the fastest growing segment of the population and the youngest. We are looking to have an Indigenous Awareness and Education Week in Brandon from September 30th to October 4th. These events will include commemorative walks, Orange Shirt Day, Sisters in Spirit on October 4th, a film screening, and other facilitated opportunities to learn about Indigenous culture all throughout Brandon, and posters and more information will follow in the coming weeks. The Brandon Urban Aboriginal Peoples Council would like to invite residents to be part of our groundbreaking event as we host a flag-raising ceremony at City Hall on October 1st from 1:30 to 3 to raise the Treaty 2 flag and Métis Infinity flag. The flags will be a permanent installation. We will hold a brief agenda for the afternoon's event, and refreshments will follow.
Very good. Thanks for bringing that up. We'll have another crack at reminding people about that probably at the next council meeting as well, so it gives people lots of head start on that one. So, other announcements. Councillor Fawcett.
Yes, thank you, through Your Worship. I'd just like to welcome back all Brandon University and ACC students to the city, and we're always glad that they come year in, year out, some of them for years and years, and some of them an old council member that sat with me for a while that was in there for a long, long time. Okay.
Well, you're in kind of the same boat. You had several degrees, I understand. So, we will see the myriad of yellow hello signs throughout the city. They're not trying to compete with the political signs that are out there, but as an annual campaign by Brandon University and Assiniboine Community College to say hello and have our community welcoming all these students. And of course we won't forget about the regular grade school students that are heading back tomorrow as well, and we can all be reminded that in all the school zones, actually kicking in, I think yesterday, the school zone speed limits of 30 kilometers an hour came into effect, so everyone can govern themselves accordingly. They get the summer off from watching those speed limits, but from September 1st on, we're back in force. So please take care and caution in those speed zones in school zones. Any other announcements? Seeing none, we can move on to the next item, please.
Under the order of general business, Your Worship, consideration of the new development concept for 1640 Sycamore Drive.
Councilor Brown.
Motion is that the concept plan attached to the report of the senior planner dated August 15th, 2019 be approved with respect to the development of 1640 Sycamore Drive. And further, that the City of Brandon enter into a development agreement with Freedom Communities Incorporated with the following conditions. I think I'd like to read out the conditions.
Please do.
Developer agrees development should be consistent with the attached site plan and Schedule B for a maximum of 208 residential multiple dwelling units, an increase to the density of development of a significant variation from the site plan will require the developer to obtain approval from City Council, who may request additional public input or require amendment to the agreement. Number two, the developer agrees to construct a sidewalk along the south side of Sycamore Drive. Number three, the developer agrees to enter into a private sewer and water agreement with the City of Brandon for the servicing of the dwelling units located within the development. This agreement is to be executed by the property owner prior to the issuance of any development and or building permits and should be registered in series with the plan of the subdivision. Number four, the developer agrees to enter into a stationary easement agreement with the City of Brandon. Such easement will serve to protect the public infrastructure extending westerly on the lands and with this of 6 meters. This agreement is to be executed by the property owner and registered on the title of the lands prior to the insurance of any development of any development agreement or building permits. Five, the developer agrees to pay a contribution towards 12 boulevard trees. The amount of payment for such trees will be due at the time of execution of this development agreement and based upon the city's tree contract pricing for the current year. Number six, developer agrees prior to issuance of any development and or building permits to contribute $202.50 per dwelling unit for 208 dwelling units to the Brandon School in lieu of land dedication totaling $42,120. Seven, the developer agrees to contribute $9,739.41 in lieu of land dedication for public reserve payment is due upon execution of the development agreement. Number eight, the developer agrees to provide the city with a detailed cost estimate for all work proposed to be completed within the city's right-of-way. The detailed cost estimate is prepared by the developer's consulting engineer and is submitted to review and acceptance by the city engineer. And number nine, the developer agrees to provide the city a letter of credit in the amount of 15% of the total cost of the detailed cost estimate, the total of which must be approved by the city engineer. And further, the City of Brandon, upon execution and registration of said new development agreement, discharge the development agreement dated February 20th, 2014, from certificate title number 2889325/2.
Very good. Seconder, please. Councilor Lupke. Okay, would move the worship to speak?
No, I think we've covered pretty well everything.
Okay, you can open it up now for discussion. And of course, if there were any specific issues, we can call back either the chief planner or the city engineer or the like if council does have some questions. So I saw hands up over here, Councillors Fawcett, DeJarle, and Cullen so far.
Yes, thank you, through your worship. One thing I would like to see if we could try to help negotiate discussion with the property owner and that developer and the developer to the south about that Willowcrest access and that. I know those are private properties and we respect the fact that it's private properties, but is there any way of our staff at least trying to work with some kind of a negotiation? Just I can't ask for anything more than that because it is private properties and we respect that, but it would be a benefit to the neighborhood if we could try to work something out there. So just do our due diligence the best we can on that.
Okay, so I think your suggestion has been heard and will be taken under advisement. And I hasten to kind of point out to council, and this maybe will help to inform some of the other questions and suggestions, and even for the sake of the residents in the room. So this is a concept plan that council is approving because of the fact there had been a concept plan several years earlier that had been approved by previous council, and now the concept similar, and then as much as a bunch of units in this large piece of property, but the concept was changing somewhat, so it was felt prudent to bring it back before council, obviously, to change the concept plan and to also give the residents and any other interested parties an opportunity to have some input. So while it's a concept plan, like not all the details have been worked out, and that will be continue to be worked upon through our planning department, engineering department, building inspection department, and the like. So a lot of these fine details that were discussed, even the applicant and a couple of the comments they made, it indicated they're not quite that level of detail yet, and so some of this stuff will be fleshed out. Hopefully the developer, I presume, was also listening very intently to some of the suggestions and questions, and you know they're likely going to want to try and build in to their final design, you know, as many things as they can to be a good neighbor, so I'm sure they were taking notes. So I just wanted to point out that this is a concept plan. We're not at the kind of fine detail state, but certainly we can discuss some of those. So thanks, Councillor Fawcett, and then Councillor DeJarly next.
Thank you through your worship, and thank you for that clarification, because my questions were going to be getting into the weeds a bit, like the, you know, the length of the sidewalk, which was a good point brought up by Mr. McMullen, and then some of those other questions I brought up, and then the on-street parking as well, just some concerns.
But I didn't want to discourage council from, you know, bringing things up that are of importance to them, and we can address them and have our professional staff address them as well. But you say we may not, they may not have those level of detail quite yet, but we can certainly flag them. So if you'd like to do that.
Yeah, I guess my concerns would be right now, and we is the on-street parking, the amount that we're going to allow, if it's going to be time limited, if it's going to be, I think that the concerns are valid given the additional vehicles that are going to be on the street, and the length of the sidewalk. Is it going to be a sidewalk to nowhere? Just some of that stuff I would want to see ironed out before I was approving or not going approving with this development.
Okay. Well, maybe we'd get one of the staff, I don't know if Ryan or Patrick wants to come forward to touch on how much of these they know, and we can get some answers to some of those questions. So, hope you're keeping up, Ryan. Certainly the length of the sidewalk, I certainly understood there's likely the sidewalk in question was the perimeter of their development and no further, but you can elaborate on that if you know it.
Yep, sure. Through your worship, to Councillor DeJarlais, so although, as your worship had stated, it's only required of the developer there for their frontage of their site, they do have walkout units, so it's not a sidewalk to nowhere. It's a sidewalk from people's units to the street where people will park on the street. But saying that, the idea was from administration that at least initially the sidewalk would go from Lindale to Tracy. So it would be extended from by the city for the other portions. So at least it would provide a connection to that intersection, so it doesn't end up just being a sidewalk to nowhere. The second discussion around parking, certainly we all know when we see these types of developments, this street will be full of street parking. Like, we're not going to shy away from this. Like, it's a large development with those front units. People will park on the street. There'll be lots of guests. Even unit owners will park on the street. I'm never amazed when I go around the city and the people who have parking in the back still park on the street just because that's more convenient. But the street was designed for street parking. If the street is parked with street parking, it's actually functioning the way it was designed to function. It's a collector street next to higher density housing. The reason why the street is wide, and the city required the developer to make it so as for people to park on the street. The discussion about speed and why there's people speeding, I would hesitant to say that it's because the street is so wide and there's nobody parking on the street. People park to the if you think of the streets that you drive down, drive downtown Ross or drive down any street, drive the east end on my street where I got street parking. Nobody's driving above 50 on that street because it's busy and it's a happening place and people are coming and going and people are paying attention. So when we're talking about speeds, having this area fully developed out and having parking on the street will narrow the way and people will just drive slower because they feel less safe.
I want to believe you. I live on a narrow street and there's been a couple of close calls. Let's just say that. I would agree with you that for the most part people will generally slow down.
Yep.
I will say that that it's yet to be seen how much slower they'll be going.
Fair enough.
What's the, sorry, Ryan, I have you up there, and I don't often ask other questions, but transit, where's the transit route down there? It goes down Sycamore?
Down Tracy and along Sycamore.
Like, do they stop anywhere in proximity to that?
Well, through your worship, to Councillor DeJarlie, we actually have transit people here today. So besides, I can go just by memory, but maybe want to come up and help me out on this one, Courtney?
Yeah. I apologize, but is it okay to...
I think I know, but she really knows.
So. So with the removal of 16 and 19, our closest stop would be actually at the Groves, which has actually been outfitted with a shelter as well. So it has security stop as well, and it is one of the lines that will update and get accessible, so we'll have a bigger pad extended. But for right now, it's just the shelter and a bench. So the Groves is just a walk and a half away from the new development that will be going.
Okay.
And that's our buses.
Those are our buses, right? But then, and we're going to figure out the school bus thing because it sounds like they're going all over.
It does, and I think goes down Tracy and then turns on Sycamore in front of the Groves and then down to
so it doesn't stop on Sycamore, like the bus
just
the,
right in front of the Groves.
Right in front of the Groves.
Yeah, and then the next one will be Sycamore and Magnolia.
So is there no parking in that area for the bus?
Yeah, from the corner Tracy. Of Tracy all the way to just I think there's an entrance into the Groves, then they won't be able to park anywhere in that area.
Okay, thank you, Courtney. So don't go away, Ryan, because some of the other council's questions may relate. So Councilor Cullen was next.
Thank you, Your Worship, through you to our presenter. I think maybe you're off the hook, Mr. Nicol, and I think I need to talk to Mr. Pulak just in regards to this drainage piece. I have some questions that maybe that would be his area of expertise. Does that work for you?
Always works for
me. Patrick, we've heard that we're going to be using a new type of a drainage system where we're having built-in retention in the parking lot. So, again, this is new to me, so it may exist some other places. And I understand this isn't a subdivision. This is a development. So we're not in a position where there's a whole entire drainage system that we're talking over acres and acres and acres where we're having to do retention ponds and things like that. But at the same time, I'm confused here because if I can just store it in a parking lot, then why would I dig a drainage storage facility or have any type of a retention pond if I could do this on a regular basis? So maybe you can just sort of bring me up to speed. Are we doing this other places? Is this acceptable practice? And do you see this as a precedent that we may regret in the future?
So through you to, through your worship to Councillor Cullen, to begin with, how we mitigate flows off sites is all the same. We treat no one development different than the other. The idea is to mitigate flows off a site so that now during a high precipitation event we're not having that inrush of flow into our storm sewer, which, you know, I've said in the past that we can't design for the storm, for some of the storms that we see. So again, we're trying to mitigate those flows. So whether we're talking about retention ponds, whether we're talking about storage on site or through subterranean holding tanks or whatever that may be, the intent is the same, is to mitigate flows. So what I've said, and I've had these conversations with our group, is that, you know, I'm not in the position to be telling people how to mitigate the flows from their site. I'm going to tell them what the boundary conditions have to be. How they accomplish that is really up to them. Now, to get back to what your question was, have I seen systems like this before? I've never had any personal experience with it, but I know for a fact that, you know, in the United States, it's quite common. I mean, just in large metropolitan areas where you don't have the space to be putting in retention ponds, you have to deal with it in parking lots. And whether you put it through subterranean holding tanks or whatever method you choose to use, it's not an uncommon method. It's just that we haven't seen a lot of it in Manitoba, or specifically, we've never seen it in Brandon. Now, for me to say, will it work or won't it work, I can't say. I just know that it's used elsewhere and it's used successfully.
Okay, just to follow up on that, so we've heard that, let's say that the parking lot fills up with a foot of water. We're here, and that's what I think I heard. So now all of a sudden we've got auto pack claims because people's cars are now filled up with water, and it's a design that we've accepted. So therefore, are we liable now for that type of a piece?
I think Ryan kind of threw out the foot. I think that was just a kind of off the hand, some water. But I think the developer was talking like 3 to 4 inches is what he's correctly suggesting their design.
I did hear 12 inches at one time, right?
Yeah, no, Ryan did say that. I'm not sure he meant that as a number, is just as it's going to be some water.
Okay.
So just so you're aware, sorry, through your worship, Councillor Cullen, at Maryland Park School, they are actually using a similar system where they, under the parking lot, they put in holding tanks. That the water drains into these tanks will overflow and discharge at a set rate that meets the requirements we've set at the boundary.
I'm hearing you're okay with this.
Yes. I mean, in the end, sorry,
go
in
to
the
an
end,
engineering
an engineer has approved the design. Yes, I am fine with it.
Okay. This may come up again, so Councillor Cameron is next.
Thank you, Your Worship. I'll trade off for Mr. Nickel there, if I could. Just being a newer member to council and not being aware sort of as much of the previous agreement and the way that potential development charges were addressed there, I know there's a point that you can't get to as far as legalities in talking about how an agreement was reached, but just I want some clarification that there is some sort of contribution to, if not development charges, but an agreement in place moving forward, that there is that level of contribution that, say, another developer coming along would have the same opportunities.
Through Your Worship, to Councillor Cameron, so when the settlement agreement was reached, the owner of the, and that's not the developer, but the owner of the time, paid a contribution to the city of $300,000. That was a lump sum payment. And it, as an agreement for that settlement, the city committed that there'd be no future off-site contributions for infrastructure property. So if it's this developer or future developer, it doesn't matter from a city perspective. We're still not charging for off-site infrastructure. So it's not really, it's just information today, whether it is a discussion. The decision was made.
Yeah, and I just wanted clarification that there was still that $300,000 that was committed at the time that would still go into...
Sorry, just to confirm, the $300,000 that was received for Sycamore, not for all the other offsite. So what happened is I didn't want to get into this in detail, but you asked the question. So like the first developer built all of Sycamore, and there was an agreement in place that when the other property developed, they would pay the other 50% contribution and the city would pay back the original developer. So there was some complications in how that was administered, and just because of the two property owners kind of not working together, this was kind of reached as the way to move forward.
Okay. No, I appreciate that, and then I understand wholeheartedly that it's not something that, you know, you wanted to get into that level of detail, but I do like that there is a commitment there.
Okay, Councilor Reggio next.
Thank you, Your Worship. Most of my questions about drainage were answered, but I do have a concern about parking. One of the ways, we've used it a couple of times in my ward to alleviate the parking problem, is have the neighbors or the neighborhood institute a two-hour parking ban by approaching City Hall. So this area, I know we're talking a few years down the road if it goes ahead, but there's nothing to say the residents can't come to City Council and say we'd like to see a two-hour parking limit on this street. Am I right?
You're partly correct, but then residents of the street are exempt from it anyway, so yeah, it would I guess kind of hold back visitors and people that don't live there, but you know, that is a facility that is used sometimes and, you know, around the university in some neighborhoods.
And it might be a way to get some of the residents to use their parking stalls, so I'll just throw that out there. Thanks.
And Councilor Lupke was next.
Thank you, Your Worship. Just to, I guess, reiterate what I had asked right about initially, is to make sure that we're looking at the pedestrian corridor crosswalk somewhere, especially when you said that the sidewalk will go from Lindale to Tracy Street. Obviously, anybody walking on the south side is wanting to get to north side when it gets to Tracy Street. So I want to make sure that we're going to look into that further. And the only other thing for me, again, I think it's along the lines of the traffic flow and just making sure that we kind of keep an eye on that moving forward once this development comes to fruition and starts being inhabited. I think we got to make sure that we keep a close eye on it to make sure everything's going smooth.
Thank you. And then Councilor Parker next.
Thank you, Your Worship. Through you to Ryan. I'll try to make this brief, but I'm not sure I can. We've had lots of concerns brought forward by folks, and I can appreciate that because it's not easy getting up in front of a bunch of stone faces and saying your piece. So, however, I'm hoping that you had some of your fears allayed a little bit, because we got the answers from experts. So we have traffic experts who are saying your street can handle that traffic. These are people that are trained in this field, is what they do. That's their thing. We had engineers tell us that the water's going to drain. You're not going to have to call NOAA anytime soon. It'll work. So it's new, but it's real and it works. And the development, as everybody knows, was originally 440 units. So now the new development is going to go down to 402, so 10% reduction. We're not asking for any exceptions to any rules, as far as I know. We got the parking is covered. We even have extra parking, I believe. Street parking is going to happen, and I think Ryan's addressed that, and I'm sure nobody's real thrilled with it, but that's where you live. That's the rules, and that's how it's set up. It's like saying you can't park on my street. I know you can, and I have to live with it. So just want to wrap up, Ryan. We're not asking for any exceptions on the approval for this concept. Everything fits within the current guidelines that bylaws allow.
Is that through your worship to Councillor Parker? You're absolutely correct. The idea here is bringing it forward to a public hearing is to just make sure everybody understands what's going on in the area, and we are getting feedback on all the, because there's been some really good items brought up where we can follow up on in the future. So we're building the neighborhood with the residents rather than just kind of moving things through the process.
Yep. Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Fawcett.
Yes, thank you, through your worship. This may be more for Mr. Pulak, but just to follow up with the other developer there had come up, Mr. McMillan. I know we've advocated quite a bit the retention ponds and that, and I do know that often they're used also as green space in a development. This one, Ryan, you had noted there wasn't a lot of green space, and you had your reasons for that, and it's not an issue that comes up, so it's got the required amount. But maybe back a little bit to a question that was asked earlier, with us sort of pushing the concept of retention ponds and those sort of things, by going ahead with this sort of thing, does it just open another door, another avenue? Like some of our developments, maybe we'd be done differently if this is an option in parking lot space? I don't know. I'm just curious.
So, through you, Richard, Councillor Fawcett, as I've said, is kind of going forward, I don't want to push for any, like when it comes to decent land that wants to be developed or subdivision. You know, we're blessed with a lot of land in Manitoba. We're not, it's not a, usually not a, an area when we're looking at a development or large-scale subdivision that's going to be an issue. So retention ponds are relatively cheap. They're easy to construct. We like the idea of going with naturalized ponds because it becomes an amenity to that area. In situations like this where you don't have the space, I mean, and I want to, you know, we've used the word, this is new. It's not new. No. This is, it is used elsewhere quite a bit. It's just that it's taken a little while to get here. And so, you know, I don't want to tell people what method they use, or people on their private property, what method they use to mitigate flows off their property. What I want to say is, listen, we only have so much capacity in our sewer system during a high water, high precipitation event. I want to be able to say, you know, you've got to discharge at this rate. How you accomplish that is really up to you. So whether you want to do it through a retention pond or you want to do it through some sort of storage in your parking lot, and that is certified by an engineer, I'm fine with that. So, you know, what is suggested here is not a, you know, maybe it might be new for Brandon, but it's mm-hmm. quite common in other places.
Councilor DeJarlick.
Yeah, thank you, through your worship. And I had put my hand up earlier just to talk about that. And I'm not sure if we're allowed to bring the developers back up. But my sense is that developers coming from BC and coming from Vancouver are going to know a little bit about stormwater and how to drain their property. And developers here might learn a thing or two about that with the size of their property and how they're trying to drain it. So my guess is they know what they're doing. They've been doing this for a while, and this seemed like the right thing to do.
Absolutely.
I don't have any other indicators of councillors that want to speak or ask questions. Thank you both, gentlemen. Just want to make sure that you weren't confining yourself to asking these gentlemen questions, but we're in the debate stage of this motion that's been duly moved and seconded. I don't see any other hands up. I'm going to chime in that, again, I think this is a very good exercise. I will, on behalf of our administration, apologize to the residents that the timeliness of the notices were not as much as we would have liked. And they did get out and hand-deliver them to give people as much notice as possible. The hearing wasn't a requirement in the first place. Our council likes to be very open and transparent with our citizens as much as we can, and that's why the hearing was held in the first place. And I think that the residents, whether every resident got here, I'm going to say that we probably heard the general gist of what everyone would say. I think people would be interested in parking and traffic and drainage and light pollution and green spaces and whatnot. So I think that was all put on the table by the residents that very thoughtfully did come out, and they did a very thorough and professional job of it. So I think that from here on in, I think our administration, as they step through the fine details of this, will try and embrace as many of these comments as possible. Developer, you know, they're not new at this, and they try to be good neighbors, and hopefully they'll try and incorporate as many of the comments that they've heard this evening from residents as well to make a good development. So again, I want to thank all of the residents for coming out and helping council to make sure all of these were addressed. So again, we apologize that the notice period was a little shorter, maybe just by a few days than what we would normally have, but I give the president credit. In spite of the long weekend and the busy time of year it is, he responded extremely well with a very thoughtful comments and feedback for us. So that said, I believe we've heard all of the comments, unless councillors had another. Councillor Chaboy, sorry.
Thank you, Worship. Just one comment. Just to add to your list, too, I respect the two women that talked about the safety for children. So if you could reassure that we'll talk about that with the school division and make sure that we review specifically this area, because there is a density issue and lots of children on the streets or on the sidewalks there, so.
Yeah, no, that frankly is an issue that, you know, we would be glad to, you know, if this development never went forward. I mean, it sounds like it's already an issue, and it would be something we'd be glad to bring forward with the school division to work out a more coordinated solution to that. So that will definitely happen, and I know the city clerk has made note of that for our next meeting. And Councillor Reggio?
Thank you, Your Worship. Just a suggestion. I don't know if it's ever been done before, or if I'll be ruled out of order or whatnot, but I'll just throw it out there, that once this development agreement, if this goes ahead, the development agreement is signed, if perhaps the developer, the city, and the residents can get together and maybe work out, you know, we heard concerns about how the construction vehicles will get to the site, and maybe that can all be taken care of in a neighborhood meeting or something. So I'll just throw that out.
Well, I think that's routinely done by administration anyways throughout developments. And you know, we're going to certainly suggest they do the best to do that, to keep people informed and where we can steer some traffic away, or we come behind and clean the street a little more often when there's debris left behind. We can do that. So thanks for that.
Thank you.
And Councillor Brown, if you'd like to close.
I was just going to mention that I'm always available if the construction vehicles are driving through the neighborhood. I can arrange it so that they take the quickest way out. We've had that problem with some of the other developers, and they've always worked with us. As far as the street cleaning, phone operations, they've always been really good at cleaning up after that. Garbage pickup in the area. Our other developers have one phone call, and they've always looked after it for us.
Very good. So presuming there are no more comments before I call for the question of the vote, did you have any, as the mover, did you have any closing comments to make, Councillor Brown?
No, I'm good with what I've heard. And
okay, with Council's permission, I'm going to call a question then on the approval of the concept plan. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Thank you very much. And again, sincerely thanks to all of the residents for your very thoughtful feedback. And we'll keep an eye on this and try and let it happen with the least amount of disruption. Next item, Madam Clerk.
The application to subdivide the property at 1201 Pacific Avenue.
Councillor DeJarle.
Thank you, Your Worship. I move that the application to subdivide 1201 Pacific Avenue, lots 1 and 2, plan 2224, to create two lots in the DMU downtown mixed-use zone be approved, subject to 1, the owner or successor of lot 2 entering into a development agreement with the City of Brandon with the following conditions: that the developer agrees to design and construct a sidewalk for the length of the newly created lot 2 in the city right-of-way concurrently with the development permit process. Any curbing replacement to facilitate sidewalk construction is to be at the sole cost of the developer. 2, the developer agrees that prior to the issuance of a development permit, the developer agrees to pay a contribution toward the removal of the boulevard trees within the Pacific Avenue right-of-way. The amount of payment for such trees will be due at the time of execution of this development agreement and based upon the city's tree contract pricing for the current year. And 3, the developer agrees to contribute $921.50 in lieu of land dedication for public reserve. Payment is due upon execution of the development agreement. And then there's a second piece for the owner of successor of lot 3. To enter into a development agreement with the City of Brandon with the following conditions: agreeing that the design and construct to design and construct a sidewalk for the length of the newly created lot 3, the developer agrees that prior to the issuance of a development permit, the developer agrees to pay a contribution toward the removal of the boulevard trees, and that the same pricing, contract pricing for the current year. That the developer agrees to contribute $858.21 in lieu of land dedication for public reserve. Payment is due upon execution of the development agreement and entering into an easement agreement with the City of Brandon and registering the easement agreement in series with the plan of subdivision.
Seconder, please. Councillor Chaboyer. Whoever wishes to speak?
Certainly, and if anybody wants administration, they can, but I think I can speak to this. This is just the subdivision of the lots where we have potentially two new groundbreaking developments for our downtown, one a microbrewery and one a kids' activity center. And this subdivision being brought forth by the potential developer of Lot 3 in order to move forward with the development.
Well said. Are there questions? We could have administration come forward if there are any, but Councillor DeJarle succinctly covered that off. But any other discussion? Call for the question then. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Next item, please.
Consideration of the applications to the Investing in Canada Infrastructure Program.
Motion from Councillor Lupke.
Thank you, Your Worship. I move that the City of Brandon support the applications for funding under the Investing in Canada Infrastructure Program for the prioritized listing of projects as outlined in the report of the City Manager dated August 26, 2019.
Seconded by Councillor Cameron. Whoever wishes to speak?
Yes, Your Worship. Obviously, this is a program put forward by senior levels of government in a cost-sharing program for some of the projects that we are looking at for the City of Brandon. And I think the City Administration and the City Manager have done a good job in what their priorities are, and certainly, as noted earlier, fit with what our strategic plan is moving forward over the next 3+ years.
Well put. Now, of course, the City Manager is in earshot here. If there are questions, they'll be easily answered. Councillor DeJarle.
Well, through Your Worship, I think it might be helpful for residents to hear what those priorities are and what we're applying for.
Great. And Mr. Sage to the podium for once.
Good evening, Your Worship, members of Council. It's been a while since I've been at the podium, so forgive me if it doesn't seem as fluid as it used to be. I appreciate the opportunity to present to you this evening. As Councillor Desjardins indicated, administration has been working on putting together a proposal for the Infrastructure Canada submissions. As you'll note in the council report, there are various streams. There's 5 priority investment streams: public transit, green infrastructure, social infrastructure, rural and northern communities, trade and transportation infrastructure. For the City of Brandon, we've put together a proposal for Council's consideration, which includes 4 projects. And the first project, which fits under the green infrastructure stream, pertains to the water treatment plant upgrade. As Council has heard from engineering over the years, this is a priority for the City and a priority for engineering. So we believe that this is a very valuable component and project to make an application for under the green infrastructure stream. Under community culture and recreation, we have 2 projects of which we're going to apply for, one being First and Veterans Way. That is the recreation complex that administration has presented to Council again over the years. Includes soccer, softball, cricket, some green space, walkways, great amenity being proposed at that location, and fits within this infrastructure stream. So that's one project we'll be applying for there. And the second one is a outdoor aquatics complex. This fits with recommendations coming out of the recreation master plan. And we felt as though if there was going to be any opportunities for partnerships and funding, that this would be another project that would be a great application to apply to the provincial and federal government. And then the fourth one that we're applying for is the 8th Street Bridge, and that falls under rural and northern communities. Again, another project that Council has been involved with and heard a few reports from engineering regarding the value and the stage that we're at. We have detailed design drawings. It's basically ready to go, and is another project that fits well within that stream. And we're hoping that the provincial and federal governments look favorably upon all 4 of these to help provide enhancements to our infrastructure in the community. So if you have any questions, I'm more than willing to help answer them to the best of my ability.
Very much. Any questions, Mr. Sage? Or it was quite detailed and on items that the council's discussed in the past. Councillor Cameron.
Thank you, Your Worship. First of all, I want to commend city crews for putting this together in a relatively short turnaround and identifying four projects that I think the residents have shared with us as projects of importance. I know you had shared this a little bit, but do you have any indication after the windows close roughly how long it is before applicants can hear back or how it's conveyed back to the city, whether they're successful on a portion or all, or hopefully all, but a portion of the funding?
Your Worship, through you to Councillor Cameron. We're in an interesting state at the current moment. We have a provincial election as well as a federal election coming up. So let's be honest, the responses and feedback might be a little delayed. The bonus is the federal program is a 12-year program that's committed to. So we would hope that we would hear back from provincial or federal officials sometime in 2020, but I can't give a guaranteed date. Having said that, myself as well as His Worship, we're always in close conversations and contact with our provincial counterparts. So the minute that, you know, the provincial election's over and the federal election is over, we'll start to reconvene with those parties and make sure that we're holding them to making sure that this is being reviewed and we get some type of feedback. Equally, once the elections are over, I always encourage our local councillors to ensure that they're making those connections with the newly elected officials and making sure that they understand what our priorities are and how important it is to our community.
Thank you. Any other questions, Mr. Sage? Very good. Thank you very much. Back to the main motion. Any further discussion? Councillor Reggio.
Thank you, Your Worship. I won't make an amendment or motion because I know where that's going to go. I support the first three projects, but I can't support project number four. So I don't know if I'm going to have to vote against this motion, even though I support the first three, but not the fourth one. I just want it on the record.
That's fine. You can just
stick into my guns.
Your conscience be your guide. For me, I'd be wanting to vote for the three I wanted, and if there's one in there, as opposed to voting against, you'd be also voting against the three that you do want. So, but you can
and
guide
it's got,
yourself.
It's got nothing to do with the fact that the media lounge didn't make it on the list again this year. But
okay, any further discussion before we call the question? I'm not sure if the mover wanted to close. Councillor Lupke?
No, Your Worship.
Okay. Councillor DeJarlais.
Just very, very briefly. I do support the ranking from administration, but my understanding is there are five different streams of funding, one of which is public transit, and we are not applying for funding for the 8th Street Bridge, for example, through that stream. And I think it's around $2 billion that's available through rural and northern communities, whereas the public transit stream is in excess of $25 billion. And under public transit, of course, the priority would be actual public transit, but there is also an area there for active transportation. And we made the decision to go forward with a bridge design that supported active transportation, going beyond just a pedestrian bridge, but making it wider so that we could potentially access active transportation dollars. And so I'm just hoping that administration has a conversation with the senior team from the government, from the federal government, just to ensure that we're applying under the right stream. Because I would think that if we have a ready-to-go project, and I think that we're very close with ours because we've done a lot of the groundwork already, that they might be willing to jump on something like that, and we could potentially access significant dollars for that bridge.
That's a fair comment. I think administration are certainly going to take under advisement. They continue to have dialogue with the secretariat of this program so that we are applying in the most appropriate, advantageous streams of the program. It's also was my understanding, because I mean you're exactly right that we did amend the sort of configuration of the bridge so it could classify as an active transportation corridor. And it was partly my understanding that, notwithstanding this specific program or not, which it didn't necessarily exist at the time. It was just generally we would not likely be successful in getting the federal government to look at it if it didn't qualify as a, you know, sort of under any program. They would just sort of say you're kind of missing the boat if we had the, you know, kind of value added of being able to classify it as an active transportation corridor. I think the advice to us was that that would enhance any application that we would make. So I'd like to think that even this stream under the rural and northern, if that's the most appropriate one, that our chances would be enhanced by the fact that it is a de facto active transportation corridor instead of a, you know, skinny little pedestrian bridge and, you know, just a single purpose bridge. So your point's well taken, and hopefully we end up in the right place that's successful. At least most of us hope we're successful. Any further discussion before we call the question? Seeing none, all those in favor? Opposed? Unopposed? That is carried. Thank you. Next item, please.
The tender for the airport vehicle garage and office.
Councilor Fawcett.
Thank you, through your worship, that the bid from LCL Construction Limited for the construction of the airport vehicle garage and office, including alternates number one, number two, number three, as per tender and specifications, at a cost of $2,067,850, net of GST, be accepted.
Second, please. Councillor Boyer, whoever wishes to speak.
Yes, thank you, Your Worship.
We do have administration. Ms. Brister is overseeing the airport at the moment, so I suspect that's why she's here, and I'm just guessing she's probably prepared to give us some highlights and answer questions.
Let's do it.
Come on ahead. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. This is my first time, so I wasn't Hey, good evening. I'm Courtney Brister, but for right now, I am the filling in as the airport coordinator. Operations coordinator, sorry. And in the last week, I've learned quite a bit about this project that I did not know. So big thank you to our financial team as well as the engineering department for helping get me caught up to speed on this. So tonight, I'll give you a brief summary of the project and then hopefully answer any questions you might have to the best of my abilities. The airport vehicle garage and office project is largely funded by the New Building Canada Fund, or the Small Communities Fund, SCF. This project is a great opportunity as it utilizes federal and provincial funding, as the project is a three-tier cost-sharing program with each level of government contributing one-third. The program provides support for projects of national, regional, and local significance to municipalities with fewer than 100,000 residents. This local project will help strengthen our community and ensure the municipal airport is better equipped to support any and all economic development in the community now and in the future to come. The full amount requested from SCF will be dedicated primarily to the new building, with additional support projects funded by the Airport Reserve as well as the Airport Improvement Reserve. These support projects will see the development of the airside apron. This is a connection from the new building to the runway, which will allow for safe access and better maneuvering equipment exiting and entering the new facility. As this is airside, it is the use of the Airport Improvement Reserve is possible. The Airport Reserve will contribute to the improved sewer and water services, which is mandatory for the function of the new building, as well as the addition of staff parking lot, which all airport employees will have the opportunity to use while on shift. The current building is outdated and inefficient, not only to use, but also in relation to operating costs. Currently, all 18 pieces of equipment are housed in one of three different buildings south of the airport, or south of the runway, pardon me, and or left outside in the elements. These buildings are used year-round, and they're full year-round. They have limited space to work and are extremely hazardous when backing equipment into these places. The current main building is unable to hold more than five vehicles at one time, four or less if an employee is working or repairing any piece of equipment. The new building will have four equipment bays, three of which have drive-through from domestic side to the airport side, as well as contain two small bays for light equipment. It will provide an efficient and safe airside access point for staff and better protect airport equipment. The airside access point will be equipped, or will better equip emergency response in the event of snow removal or in any sort of an emergency situation, ensuring the safe arrival and departures of all aircrafts. This project is anticipated to commence as soon as possible after the project is awarded and provides several benefits to the city. For example, utilizing available funding programs to ensure the city does not have to fund the project 100% from city dollars, increased staff productivity, efficiency, as well as safety concerns and improved service overall, as well as reduced building operating costs due to being more energy efficient. Multiple bids were received for this project, with all six being competitive bids that were within the same range. The total bid price does not exceed the total approved 2019 budget of just over $2.9 million and does include prices for all three accepted alternates, these being the asphalt parking lot and approach for the new garage on the domestic side, the credenza in the meeting room, as well as the removal and disposal of the gun butt debris. In summary, it is administration's recommendation to award the project to the lowest bidder, LCL Construction Limited. Questions, I would be more than happy to attempt to answer.
That was, no offense, Councillor Foster, that's much more thorough than I was expecting from you. So. We'll open up the floor to any questions. Councillor Chaboy.
Thank you, Worship. Through the presenter, I just want a clarification. You mentioned that you do have within your operating budget already funds to operate, heat, and maintain this new asset or new building?
Through your worship to the councillor, I believe this all comes out of building maintenance. And we'll continue to do so with the new building.
Okay. Councillor Cameron.
Thank you, Your Worship. This is potentially a question for Mr. Hammond or Ms. Rochelle or whomever would like to approach the podium. I was just wondering, with the expenditures out of the main airport reserve, what kind of balance remains in the reserve following, just because we are doing budget considerations coming up for 2020, so I just was hoping to get what a balance would be remaining in the reserve.
Through your worship to the councillor, that definitely is a good question for Dean.
Through your worship to Councillor Cameron, as Ms. Brister pointed out, the total anticipated for the cost, including ancillary costs and contingencies, are $2.9 million. Should we need to expend those full amounts for this project, then of the two reserves that are funding this project, that would leave $242,000 in the airport reserve and $267,000 in the airport improvement reserve.
Okay. And Councillor Reggio.
Thank you, Your Worship. I'm going to go out on the limb again on this one. A few years ago, I asked about the North American Free Trade Agreement and how it affects tenders and local. Now that the North American Free Trade Agreement is kind of in suspension, we don't have a new agreement, I'm just wondering if we can give preference to local contractors, or is NAFTA still kind of hanging over our head?
Well, Dean has the answer to that, because I would have made one up, but I think apart from NAFTA, I think we're still in, certainly when we receive
I understand, but
yeah.
Just point of information, that it's the agreement of internal trade that actually dictates that, not NAFTA.
Okay.
Okay, and now Councillor Fawcett.
Yes, thank you, through your worship, Ms. Brister. Good job. That was what I was going to say. Do you know, is there going to be any disruption at the airport and such while this takes place? Is there a timeline on this project? Is, you know, what can people expect when they're up there? Do you know if it'll disrupt any more than the current road construction? Or?
Through your worship to the councillor, there are provisions in the contract to ensure that there is very little, if no, airport operations affected. They are supposed to be working around the daily flights as well, so there should not be any serious impact when they are working airside.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Question? Any others? Okay, thank you very much, Courtney. That was very thorough. So back to the main motion. Any further discussion? Who wish to close?
All said. Thank you.
Very good. I'm going to call for the question then. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Next item, please.
The proposal for the automated fare collection system, the onboard announcement system, and the CAD ADL software for the transit system.
Very good. Motion, go ahead, Councilor Fawcett.
Thank you, through your worship, that the proposal from Trapeze Software ULC DBA TripSpark Technologies for the supply and installation of a new automated fare collection system, onboard announcement system, and CAD CAD AVL software as per proposal at a cost of $915,780 net of GST be accepted.
Seconder, please. Councilor Cameron. Mover wish to speak, or would you like Ms. Brewster to provide your comments?
Yes, sir, your worship. I will ask Ms. Brewster to do this one. I'm not as, I had the other one down, Pat.
Okay. The other one's in your ward, so. Welcome back.
Thank you. Amanda Dupuis is actually going to be helping me with this presentation as well, because she's very well versed with this company as well, or this project, sorry.
Yeah. So I'm Amanda Dupuis, the Transportation Systems Analyst, so we're ready to give you some highlights about this project that's being proposed.
So there's already an overview provided for you for the council report, and we just wanted to give you a little bit more information about this project for your consideration. We currently have fare boxes that are provided through TripSpark on all of our buses. This aging hardware is coming to the end of its life cycle, and all units will need to be replaced shortly to continue offering superior customer service and reports that offer accurate ridership details. This project is needed for transit because the onboard announcement piece will ensure improved accessibility. This integrated onboard system will provide voice announcements and bright LED screens that clearly communicate the next stop to all passengers based on the GPS data. This project complies with Manitoba legislation to ensure that accessibility is improved for not only those residents who do need it, but for all residents who utilize public transit.
The computer-aided dispatch and automatic vehicle location street software is needed because without it, we're unable to move forward on the onboard announcement system that Courtney talked about. Because it's PTIF funded, the onboard announcement system, but without the CAD ABL, that won't work. So they're fully integrated. We can't do one without the other. This software will also increase dispatcher efficiencies as they'll have access to real-time bus location data that can be used in the event of an emergency or to give vehicle location to fleet staff when necessary or if a customer has an inquiry about where their bus is. It also has the ability to report on operational and safety related issues such as speeding and ensuring that we're being efficient in our arrival and departure times. The bid from TripSpark was not the lowest. However, we recommend this company because we had a team that was involved in evaluation and scoring, and through the procurement process, there were proposals that were evaluated on many criteria that included adherence to technical specifications, their implementation schedule, we checked references and looked at past performance, as well as the ongoing annual fees and the initial price of the system, as well as demonstrations. So all these components were scored, and TripSpark received a higher scoring, even taking into account that the initial cost is a little bit higher.
The 2019 financial plan includes a total budget for this project of $1 million. This is being partially funded by the federal government through the Public Transit Infrastructure Fund program. The remainder of the project is being funded through the Transit Gas Tax Reserve as well as the Transit Equipment Reserve. There will be an additional cost expected for contingencies. However, it is not anticipated that this will go over budget. Administration's recommendation is that we accept the bid from TripSpark Technologies for the supply and installation of this system. Questions? We would love to answer.
Very good. Well done to both of you. So we'll open up the floor. Councilor Reggio.
You mentioned annual fees. Can you tell us what those are or what they will be?
The annual fees, like we currently have annual fees that we pay from this company, the first year in 2020 is not going to go up because the first year is going to be covered for, like right now we pay for hardware warranty, and we won't have to because the first year warranty will be covered. The second year will go up about $12,000 for 2021 for annual maintenance.
So is that what we'll pay as an annual fee is $12,000?
No, the $12,000 is the increase over what we currently pay.
What do we currently pay?
It's at $40,000.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, and then Councilor Cameron.
Thank you, Your Worship. First of all, I commend any work that goes into helping people with specific needs on buses. That's very positive. I was just wondering with regards to this work and sort of future-proofing, I guess, in a way, do you anticipate other changes that maybe need to be made to the buses in the next even years that would need to be proceeded with to sort of fall in line with the Accessibility for Manitobans Act, or does this sort of get us to compliance, I guess, in a way?
Through your worship to the councillor, there are a few different things that we are looking at doing as well, including upgrading our stops throughout the system to help make those more accessible. But as far as on the bus, this is pretty close to being good. I couldn't speak right now to whether or not there's any more specific details, but it does cover quite a few of those little check marks.
And Councillor Reggio.
Thank you. Just as a follow-up question, the screens, will they be one in the front and one in the side or the rear passenger door so that folks will have a good shot on? I know when I used to ride Calgary Transit, the buses and the C trains always had the signs above the exits. Is that going to be the case with Brandon Transit, or can you let the riders know where the signs will be?
Through your worship to the councillor, we are one screen will be installed at the front of the bus where your requested stop kind of goes, so right at the front. The screen is big enough that it should accommodate everybody in the bus as well. We are we've been reassured that people will be able to see them. Most buses our size only do have the one, unless they're articulating with the movement in the middle. So we are fairly confident that mostly everybody will be able to see, and hearing wise they should be able to hear throughout the whole bus.
Thank you.
There's both a visual and audible
indicator.
So if you have sight impairment, you're going to hear the audible one. Other questions? Councillor Lupke.
Thank you, Your Worship, through you to our presenters. Just wondering if you could provide a little bit more detail on why this system was better than the other system that came in on the lower part of the tender.
So the bidder's information is like held in strictest confidence, and we can't actually divulge under their procurement policy except for just that there was the scoring that was done and they scored higher, just because there could be some proprietary information that could give competitive advantage. So if you need somebody to speak more on that.
So again, she indicated the factors that they used, that they scored on, and then it comes out. So price is one of the things they score on. So obviously, if your price is higher, you're not going to score as well on that factor. So that would have scored you down. But then they obviously must have scored higher on all the other ones that overcame their higher price to yield them as the number one, you know, and then of course the ongoing costs would have been factored into it as well, and comes out, you know, it's kind of like everything we see that has come to us has been scored. It's the same idea. I'm not sure, Rod, if you've got more to add or whether
Your Worship, through you to council again, Amanda and Courtney summed it up best. Through procurement and proprietary rights, we're not able to start sharing what vendors might have scored better on others, because then the competition gets a leg up. That information can be shared through procurement to the vendor if they're so wishing. However, it's not public information that we're able to disclose in a council forum.
Not sure if that answers your question, but that's the best we can do. Other questions? Councillor Fawcett.
Thank you, through your worship. When will these be installed? When will we get these? I know sometimes with the buses, when we're waiting for buses, they take a year or so to get here, but these things, they probably should be able to get installed reasonably soon and without downtime on the routes.
Through your worship to the councillor, absolutely, there will be no downtime. We'll just switch buses on and off, and they will get installed systematically. We won't anticipate any buses being down for longer than. And we actually are on a very tight timeline with this because of the PTIF component and having to have that paid out by a specific time. So they have stated that they will get it done by
the end of March.
Mid-March, I believe, is their timeline. So it should be fairly quick turnaround for this one.
Thank you. Any other questions? Seeing none, thank you both very much. Back to the main motion. Any further discussion?
No.
Before I ask the mover to close, would you like to close? If not, I'm going to call the question then. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Thank you. Next item, please.
Under the order of bylaws, Your Worship, bylaw number 7243, which is an amendment to the North Brandon Gateway Secondary Plan.
Councillor Fawcett.
Thank you, through Your Worship. That bylaw number 7243 to amend bylaw number 7079 to incorporate updates to the Brandon Northern Gateway Secondary Plan be read a first time.
Seconder, please. Councillor Parker. First reading, not normally a debatable, just process starts, so we're going to call a question then. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Next item, please.
Bylaw number 7251, an amendment to the business licensing bylaw regarding massage therapy businesses.
Councillor DeJarlie.
Thank you, through Your Worship. I move the bylaw number 7251 to amend the business licensing bylaw number 6009-4692 to clarify and update rules on massage therapists be read a second time.
Seconder, please. Councillor Chaboyer. Mover wish to speak?
I'll wait till the third reading, if that's okay.
Okay. Any other discussion then on second reading? Seeing none, we'll call for the question then. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Third reading would be in order. Councillor DeJarlie.
Thank you, through Your Worship. Let the bylaw be read a third and final time.
Seconder. Councillor Chaboyer. Mover wish to speak?
Very briefly, back in the day, we wanted to add some protective measures to ensure that massage therapy businesses were indeed massage therapists, and this wasn't going to be massage parlors per se. And I think we're pretty confident in that, and so administration has decided to let the new massage therapists that are trying to start up businesses off the hook by having to come to council to get their license.
Yeah, and further to that, the industry, the profession rather, is now, you know, regulated, you know, provincially. You know, they have their own professional association and the like, so now we can, you know, basically defer to that level of credentials that didn't used to exist, as you call it, back in the day. And I have to confess, I was on council kind of back in the day, not necessarily when they started, but we used to deal with these periodically before massage therapy was the profession it is today. So again, with all these advancements in the regulatory framework, primarily provincially, it really allows council to kind of, you know, stand down a little bit and make things easier for massage therapists in our community to get up and running. Any further discussion? Any questions? Seeing none, we're going to call for the question then. Again, third reading, recorded vote is in order. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried unanimously. Next item, please.
Bylaw number 7254 to rezone 1501 Moreland Avenue.
Councillor Fawcett.
Thank you, through Your Worship. To rezone, that bylaw number 7254 to rezone part of 1501 Moreland Avenue from development reserve to residential mobile modular home be read a first time.
Seconder, please. Councillor Parker. In first reading, no debate. Call for the question. All those in favor? Opposed? That's carried. Next item, please.
Giving of notice, Your Worship.
The giving of notice this evening. Seeing none, next item, please.
A motion to adjourn would be in order.
Before I call for adjournment, it must be a special occasion. It's either Councillor Berry's birthday or some special occasion, because we've had special guests and his mother in the gallery tonight, and I've never seen Councillor Berry more quiet. Now I will take a motion to adjourn. Councillor Berry, seconded by Councillor Chaboyer. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Thank you very much.
I should have asked what was wrong. Actually.
No.
We're all for getting his mom out to every one of these.
Can we bring